Well, hello and welcome. I thought I'd talk a little bit today about the Eucharist and the reason Cardinal O'Malley of Boston, just this Corpus Christi Sunday last June, declared in his diocese a year of the Eucharist. And he was motivated because of the increasing polls that are coming out from the Pew Foundation, as well as CARA, the Center for Applied Research on the Apostolate, which shows that Catholics are losing their sense of Holy Communion or the Eucharist as the real presence. So I thought I'd talk today a little bit about the Eucharist on several levels, just to kind of go through a real summary of what the Church actually says about this communion that we receive every Sunday. Now, interestingly, because Cardinal O'Malley and Pope Francis are close, I understand that the Pope is planning this coming Corpus Christi until Corpus Christi 2022, that he may in fact invoke a year of the Eucharist, primarily because of this COVID virus. People have not been able to come to church, have not been able to receive the Eucharist, and there's a fear that, again, people will wander away from really understanding what it is that we do here on Sunday, thinking that perhaps it's, you know, not that important, or just to view it on TV or on the video is good enough. So I'd like to go through some of this. Now, the first thing is that many people refer to what we receive at Mass on Sunday as Holy Communion. Now, what does that exactly mean when we say Holy Communion? But you have to look at the word communion. Communion in Latin, communio, which means we're all together. We're all one, we're one body. And so when we come to church on Sunday to receive communion, the symbolism there is that we are of one faith and that we believe in the presence of Jesus Christ in the what we call the sacred species, which is the transubstantiated bread and wine. So communion means we all are together. And here's the rub. You know, why is it that some non-Catholics or even non-Christians cannot receive Holy Communion? Well, that was settled by Pope John Paul some years ago when the question was asked, well, if it is really the real presence, wouldn't it be good for everybody to receive so that Christ would bring people together? And the Pope said, no, the symbol is that we are already together. We believe in the Church, we believe in what it teaches, and we believe in the real presence. And so only those who truly believe that should come and receive in communion with each other. So that's what that's all about. Now here's something that you might not have thought about. When we talk about Holy Communion and communio and communion, it also refers to the communion of saints, and that we are connected whether we're alive or we have died. We are still connected in the communion of saints. We celebrate that in November on the Feast of All Saints Day. And so one of the things that happens, you know, I remember when I was taught to go to Holy Communion at Mass, and after you receive, you sit down in the pew, and you put your hands over your face, and you talk to Jesus, and it's you and the Lord. Well, the truth is that wherever Jesus is, there is heaven. And wherever heaven is, there are all those angels and saints and people who, our loved ones who have gone before us in faith. And the Orthodox, who also believe in the real presence and do have, in fact, the real Holy Communion, the real Eucharist, they expand that. They say when you go to the, what they call, they don't call it the Mass, they call it the Divine Liturgy. When you go to the Divine Liturgy, not only are we all connected, but all your loved ones who have gone before us in faith, it's the saints, the angels, are all there. And that's a real part of what we mean by Holy Communion. So I thought I'd just kind of bring that up. So when you come to church on Sunday, and you've received the Blessed Sacrament. You're also not only in communion with everyone else in the church and every other Catholic, but all your loved ones who may have gone before us in faith in heaven. Now, the other big word is Eucharist. And you often hear the priests not refer to Holy Communion, but refer to the Eucharist. So what's this all about? Well, the Eucharist is actually a Greek word, and it means thanksgiving. And so, in point of fact, it is thanksgiving for what Jesus did for us in the holy sacrifice on the cross on Good Friday that we remember. And we not only remember that event, but we remember the Last Supper. And of course, Jesus said when he, at that Last Supper, take and eat. This is my body. Take and drink. This is my blood. And as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. So it's a remembrance not only of that event, but we literally take what Jesus said as his body and blood is his real body and blood. So now that gets me into the third little definition I talked about, is what do we mean by real presence? Real presence. So when we come to church on Sunday, when the priest brings his hands over the bread and the wine and the cup and the chalice, he says a prayer, and he begins that prayer, and that prayer calls down the Holy Spirit, which actually begins the whole process of what we in the Catholic Church call transubstantiation. And then when he says those words, and the bread and the wine become the body and blood, Christ is truly present. Christ is really there just under the appearances of bread and wine, but he's truly present. Now, actually, there are several ways in which Christ is present in any sacrament that you receive. For instance, in baptism, whether it's a priest or whether it's a deacon, it isn't the deacon or the priest who's baptizing. He stands in the presence of Christ, and it is Christ who truly baptizes. As a matter of fact, there was a little controversy about that just recently. It turns out that there was a priest out in the Midwest, and he had been ordained a priest, and he saw a video of his baptism, and he was being baptized by a deacon. I should go like this. Oh. And the deacon said, "We baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." Well, it turns out that that's not the formula, and he wasn't really baptized. It was not only illicit, it was invalid. And it caused a major uproar. And so the instruction came out, you must say, "I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." The reason is because it's not the priest or the deacon who baptizes, it's Christ who baptizes. So the presence of Christ in the sacraments are there. Let's get back to the Eucharist real quick. So when we're talking about the real presence, the thing is, when you come to church on Sunday, and this should kind of blow your mind, the presence of Christ is in the person of the priest. As a matter of fact, there's a Latin term for it, it's in persona Christi. Especially in the Eucharistic species, the bread and the wine that become the body and blood, especially there. But also in the Word. So there may be a lector or a deacon who is reading, but it is actually Christ who's reading. It's the word of the Lord that's coming direct from his mouth to you. So he's present there in the Word. And then, for those who have received Holy Communion and the Eucharist, and even if you haven't received, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am. So Christ is present in the people. Now, I'm going to go into that a little bit more here in a second. When we talk about the Mass, here's something that I don't know everybody really appreciates this when they come to church on Sunday. So, you know, the Mass continues, and I'm just going to do a real quick little walkthrough on this thing. So the Mass continues, and you hear the Word, Jesus is in the Word, but then comes the time when the priests confect, what they call confect the sacrament. And so he says, you know, this is my body, this is my blood, and the bread and wine become the body and blood of Christ. Now, if you really ponder that for a second, you just stop right there and ponder it. That's awesome. When you think about that, just that is awesome that Christ himself is present. Now, in fact, you can stop the Mass right there. I mean, that's an amazing miracle, you know. But the Mass doesn't stop right there. As a matter of fact, we have a rite in the church where it would just stop right there, and it's called the Adoration of the Blessed Sacrament. And a lot of people in a lot of churches have that, some on a perpetual 24-hour basis. But that's not the end of it, is it? Because the Mass goes on, and then we receive the actual body and blood of Christ. And when you think about that, that's also awesome. As a matter of fact, there's a prayer that the priest or the deacon says when he takes a little bit of water and pours it into the wine just before the consecration. It's called a secret prayer, and I think it ought to be a loud prayer, not a secret prayer. And the words are, you know, may the mingling of this water and wine come to symbolize our sharing in Christ's divinity, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. We share in Christ's divinity. Now, think about that for a second. The early patristic church, you know, the great fathers in the early hundreds, you know, they were big on this. They said, we become divinized. We actually become divinized. Now, we kind of got away from that in the church, you know, thinking about that, because I think they didn't want people to think wonders who they were, and didn't want their egos to get carried away. And of course, one of the songs that a lot of us had at our first communion, which I think in retrospect, in looking back, is a terrible thing for little second graders to have to sing at their first communion, is, oh Lord, I am not worthy. I mean, you know, little kids, you know, aren't big sinners, and so I'm not so sure that it really is an appropriate hymn. But don't tell the bishop I said that. In any event, we have this awesome event where you actually become divinized. And in some ways, we have a modern phrase, you know, you are what you eat. You've heard of that, you know. Well, it's kind of literally true with the Blessed Sacrament. Now, we could stop the Mass right there, and that would be awesome, wouldn't it? But remember, I also said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am. And when we're actually receive the body and blood of Christ, we're commissioned at the end to go out and be Christ to other people. And there it is. That's the thing I wonder that a lot of people forget about. You know, it's not a me and you, Lord, and now I've got you. It doesn't stop there. I mean, that's true. But then you have to go out there, and there's a responsibility and an obligation to be Christ to others. So I thought I'd run through that real quick. I hope that it sticks with you a little bit the next time you come to church. And if I happen to see you at Mass and you kind of have your mouth dropped and you're in awe,